Hello, everyone. My name is Sandra Kucina, and I'm from Croatia. First of all, I think I'm enthusiast because I always think that everything will settle positively in the end. So just need patience. Well, I work as assistant director for education user support in the University Computing Center. Also, I'm heading the e-learning center at the national level for all higher education institutions. So basically, I'm going to talk about something completely different than primary, secondary school because my field is higher education. So, be prepared to listen. I pick from several documents three sentences saying that we should focus on teacher training and educating teaching staff to do a job. Yesterday and today we heard from several speakers that we want high quality in teaching and professionalism in teaching to able to make changes, to have students who are motivated, who are innovative, and who want to listen. It's not so easy, and I would say that the teacher today has a very tough role. Apart from that, maybe teacher profession is not so much appreciate it anymore because the research always is more important, more financed, more used for the advancement in profession. Teaching maybe as a profession neglected a little, but nevertheless teachers enjoy their work, they are very good in it, and they always try to do the best, and I think that they are enthusiasm is the most appreciated factor that makes them move and do their job as best as they can. But in order to have skilled teachers, to have competent teachers who can do such a good job, we have to provide them with some kind of support. I will give you an overview of my country because I cannot say that everywhere else is the same, but I think that you will recognize some parts of our situation in your country as well. So since 2014, we have a strategy of education, science and technology. And in this strategy, it is stated that education and science are priorities. Also, it is stressed that there is importance of using ICT in educational process, that we want modern methods of teaching based on ICT and development of open educational resources. And also, it is said that continuous professional development in pedagogy and other transversal competencies, it's important to provide for teachers. So, like any strategy, it's just a nice piece of paper. But actually, from paper to the action, there is a long, long way. And there has been some changes, but still lots of things to do. So I stated, but we still do not have any recognition of teaching excellence. We don't have initial training for higher education teachers. We have a continual professional development of teachers as optional, and it's just left to themselves to decide if they want to pursue it. Environment, although talking about modern education, about open education, about skills needed for 21st century, is very much still traditionally oriented towards traditional way of teaching. There are good examples, and I think that we just need some time to become more mainstream in this field. But there are some universities which already has the strategies on e-learning, also implemented openness. There are also examples at the good practice at some institution, but it's very diversified. And so at one point you will find everything really great, and the other point you will find institutions and teachers who has never heard yet about e-learning or open education. So it just shows that importance of providing sustainable systematic support to teacher in the process of changing education. So what are the questions? As I work with teacher, my job is to support institutions and teachers in implementation of new technologies. So when I work with teachers, these are some of the questions which I get quite often. I just pick some of them that are not all. But you see, when they decide to start with use of technologies, first, they don't have time to find out which technologies to use, which are available technologies. Are these technologies available to them? Are these technologies available to their students as well, if they want to use it? How to integrate these technologies in teaching and learning process? Which are the pedagogical approaches? What is a student-centered model? Because, you know, for ages they have been taught in a way that they were listening to a teacher and writing in the notebook, and that was what they learned during their studies and applied in their work for 20 years. And now I come to them and say, okay, you have to do something completely different. And usually they tell me, but you came out quite fine with this way of teaching we had, so why should we change now? And sometimes it's quite difficult to provide them answer because they are very good teachers indeed in the classroom, but they just don't understand the benefits, the possibilities of technology in improvement of their teaching. They often do not know how to use new formats of educational resources. They are aware of lots of things at internet, the videos, the animations, the articles, something which they can use, but how to use it? Is it free? It's available? Is it open? Under which licenses? How to integrate it in their course? So it's lots of questions. And as the technologies every day are getting faster and faster in a way that every day you will find, I would say, at least 50 new applications, ideas, and possible uses of some kind of software, it's very difficult to follow what's going on. We had quite a long time when we started to use PowerPoint presentation to adapt to that and to see how to use that. But now we don't have so many time when you try to use something new, because today it's interesting, tomorrow maybe it's already passé, you know, like in a few years before the Second World as a virtual world was really in high level of talking about it, of using it. Today it still exists, but it's not so I would say trendy in a way that everybody talks about it. So maybe there are quite new virtual worlds which can be discovered. Also, in that, where to find the support? Okay, I want to do it, but I cannot do it on my own. I have my subject expertise, I have 300 students, I have to think about my advancement, lots of other things. I have to do research. Because I cannot be only a teacher, I have to be a researcher as well. And so in all that task they have, it's very important to provide them with support. But where they come and ask all stupid questions, they say, I have a stupid question. I say, I'm not afraid of your stupid questions. They are all usually easy to answer. But if you have a clever one, it will take me at least 2 weeks to find out the solution for what you have asked me. Because they are very creative and innovative in their own way. And when they say, okay, I want for this topic in my course to make it like... that students participate, give feedback, that they have some peer reviewing, that I do it. And so they have ideas, and sometimes it's very difficult to provide them with possible solutions for these ideas. So at eLearning Center, I have a team of 7 people who has to do hard thinking sometimes in order to try to find answers to all questions, which I would say very appreciated, because they make us think more how to be creative. But usually the questions are rather simple than just helping them to move on. So this is something which we did with the teachers on one workshop. So they said, when we asked them, do teachers need support? And you see that they wrote in the big letter, yes. So, well, when they ask me why to use ICT in teaching, and I usually say to make a better teaching. Actually, if the teacher is not good at teaching in the classroom, technology wouldn't help to improve his teaching. Good teachers will always make online teaching as well good as in classroom. So what we want to have, we want to have happier students and happier teachers. They want them to be both satisfied. But it's not about technology, it's about methodology. And often we neglect that part because we think if we provide the laptops, if we provide softwares, the application, in the infrastructure, then we have done our job. And often we neglect the importance that we also teach the teacher how to use these technologies and how to implement them in the educational process. I'm sure that lots of you have seen this this graph, like stages of technology adoption, but Zemsky and Massey, it's been a long time since they developed this graph. But in my country, I can say that 10 years ago when I started to do it, we were somewhere here online between early adopters and early majority. And after 10 years, I'm happy that now we have passed the early majority, but we still have lots to go on. And you can see it took 10 years to move such a short way. And I'm not sure that in another country it's going faster, but it's going. So I will just pass quickly through these types of teachers. I'm sure you all know the innovators, and thanks God for them because they are always first to try something. And I'm always admiring their energy to try to do, to make something. But we also have to think about what they need. They actually need legislation of their work when they are inventing something new, that it's not just that they are doing it for themselves, that it's something good that will also be good for their students and institution. They also need resources and education and recognition of their work. If you look at the early adopters, so they will try new ideas, but in a careful way, and I usually try to find the institution person who are early adopters, who will listen to me and who are ready to try something with the guidance. Also, they like to have guidance during their way of implementing something. And also, like the others, they also need resources, education, recognition, and visibility of their work. If we come to early majority, so this is a group of people who is waiting to be pushed, who is waiting that it's a decision on the level of institution, who wants to see some positive examples that something has been going on quite well for some time, and then they are ready to move on. Also, they need instruction and all kind of support. And late majority, well, those people, you just leave them be. There are small amount of people, but I don't think there's anything we can do. It's so much time-consuming to explain to them things, but that it's usually not worth. So what is important is that we need to think about that we have different kinds of support that teachers need, political, organizational, methodological, and technological. And I just quickly pass through all of this. Political, if there's no strategy on a national level, on institution level, there's no policy that they will support teachers and they provide the infrastructure and anything they need to do, there's no budget to finance it, then it's very difficult. It will just be a teacher's initiative who will be, as long as they have enthusiasm, but when they burn out will stay. Also, the culture change is very important. It's not just the teachers need to change, there's institution change as well, present with management and administrative part as well. Organizational support, so providing them with examples, how can they do it, giving them instructions, support, and ensure the visibility of their results. Methodological support, okay, they know how to do the courses in the classroom, but having an online course is not just taking material from classroom and put it online. You have to find another way to do it. So course design is very important. Creating materials, lecturing in online environment, providing tutoring and mentoring. We are talking about student-centered work. So different role of teacher. How to manage group work. So lots of issues which they have to learn and find out how to do it. And also technological infrastructure is very important. Tools, education, how to use some technologies and support in that. So from the teacher support, if you see from this picture, we always said, let's start with our needs. Do ask us what we need. Don't presume what we need, just talk with us. And I always say, we are not working for teachers, we are working with teachers, and that's quite a difference. So basically my institution is working in support to teachers in higher education. So we provide lots of technologies and tools, but what I am always very happy to say, most of all, we provide support to teacher. We are the place where they can come and talk and ask whenever they want, and we will try to find the solution. We never say no. We always try to find some way to see how we can help them. As I said, we have to listen to them, work with them, and we have to find different approach for different kind of teachers. So I have a group of 7 people, guys and boys, and I usually see when I'm going to say which, who I'm going to send to talk to teacher. Some of teachers are older and they need more patience and more time for explanation. Those younger need quicker results, moving faster. So you have to find a way how to work with teachers to make him or her feel comfortable. And so I coming to conclusion, and I think that at this conclusion we can discuss our discussion later. So teachers have positive attitude towards new technology. Let's use it. Let's use it, but not in a way that we left them to on their own. Also, we should make additional emphasis to raise teacher awareness on possibilities to use new technologies in educational process. Also, if we do not recognize their effort in teaching and promotion, there's difficulties in their advancement and moving on. They also usually say, I do that, I put lots of effort into my teaching, but my colleague is not doing that, and we have the same salary. And he has a poor teaching, and I'm very much innovative and trying to make things better and to work with my students, but nobody is taking on this part. They're just looking at my research. Showing example of good practice in use of e-learning can contribute to recognizing the possibilities and benefits of new technologies. And if it's not a part of overall strategy or national strategy, as Jeff said this morning, if there's no communication between institutions and government, it's not a policy level on a national level, then it's very difficult to explain to teacher why he or she should do it, while others don't have to do it. So I think that there are lots of issues, but the importance of teacher support and teacher training is, I think, in high priority. Thank you.
We have time for discussion, another 20 minutes available on all the kind of many yes. points that you raised, especially on the conclusions. Please, you can moderate the discussion. Yes,
okay.
And anyone okay. who wishes to make a point.
So, do you share my opinion, or you have some different experience in your countries?
Thanks very much. I have a question, actually. It was about what you said about late majority.
Yes.
And how they are maybe not worth spending time on. And I just wanted to ask, is that always the case in your experience? Because I think I'm more idealistic, but I don't work I'm not there working in it, so I'm idealistic without practice of it. But I thought that if you have incentives and if they can see it working and if they can, if their reasons can be explored, that maybe there is hope or, yeah, I'd be interested in your views.
From my experience, I will always try. I will always try, but sometimes they just have their own opinion. There's nothing that will change their opinion. And I think then it's better to let them be, because otherwise it will be just like some kind of accusations between each other or difficulties in the environment. And it's quite a small amount of people, but they became very passionate in defending their own attitudes and ways of work. And I usually say there's nothing they can say that I didn't hear before. So I can immediately recognize such a person. I'll try, but if I don't see there's any point, I just let them be, because they are mostly at the end of their working age at the faculties. Usually in Croatia it's 65, then they have to retire. So I usually then let them have peaceful. Peaceful way till retirement.
I fully agree with unfortunately, while I tend to be very idealistic, I am a head of school here, and you know, you have these new, even innovative ideas, but even let's go to basic things like using an interactive whiteboard, which is widely available in every classroom here in Malta. However, then, yes, I keep my hopes very high, but at the same time, there are those, and then you have to say, okay, but how big is this problem? And then it is true, it's just a few people who are not on board, but those few sometimes would even bring you down when you are trying to implement change. And you know, many people are on board, but those people manage to drag you, so you have to be very careful. So while you're trying to actually bring them on board in every way possible, the amount of energy you spend to do so can actually pull you down, because you have so many other things, and then you can spend that energy on the people who you can really invest in and have actual peer influence, which can even then maybe bring about some change in them, seeing, as you mentioned, you know, if you actually say examples of good practice are actually, you know, get opportunities for members of staff who are on board to give, you know, to show that this works. I think when this change is when you actually see that teachers will change will happen when they see that they can get results for their effort. So if that is possible through examples of good practice, maybe even these diehards, it's difficult. You know, you can actually, I'm sure you can, like I can, picture the people, you know, you can see. But yes, I think it's good to remain with hope, because hope is the last to die, but at the same time, have to be realistic about it. Thank you.
This is why my title is Lost and Found in Digital Age, because they're usually lost, and I don't want to praise myself, but when they come to us, we usually provide them with some information, and they get, oh, yes, 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 and they found themselves, and they much more... It's smoothier transition to new things. So if they're on their own, like lone rangers, you know, at the beginning when we started to work, I collected all these lone rangers to some meetings and some events, and they said, "Oh, you're doing the same thing. Oh, you're doing this thing. I'm not alone." So it took time that recognized that they are not alone in that, and also. To start to share experience, because when they thought they are alone, they didn't share even the experience. They didn't show to anyone what they are doing, because they thought nobody else will think positively about that. So it's very important to make them feel comfortable, to make them feel aware of the possibilities. They're much more less reluctant to try. They get motivation if they see they can get some support. But how far this enthusiasm and support can go if we don't recognize their efforts, if we don't invest in their training, if we don't invest in making possibilities to change the teaching process. We cannot say to him, okay, now you have some tools, use them, and make change. It's not working. We have all stakeholders have to be in that, administration, management, national level. Students also can be engaged. I usually tell teachers, if you have good students, take advantage of that. Don't be afraid of them. Ask them to help you with the course, to put materials or do some search on internet. Not grading, okay, that you leave it to yourself, but take advantage of that and use the students, because sometimes teachers are on their own. They don't have assistant, and they have a number of students, and it's very difficult to organize that. So we have to be quite aware that teacher need support if we want him or her to do what we want actually. We want them to do something, but we actually are not quite clear always what we want them to do. Because when the Bologna process started in 2005, we said we want changes, but actually it took us five or 6 years till we find out what are learning outcomes, what is a student-centered learning, how to do it. So it's not easy, it's not easy.
Thank you very much for the presentation. I would like to focus on the last point of the conclusion, because I think that most of the ideas you presented mainly apply to teachers in secondary schools.
In higher education.
But some of them maybe can be applied. For example, I can take this example of teachers have positive attitude towards new technology. Mm-hmm. If you go to a conventional university, let's say, and I'm going to take the case of the University of Cyprus, which is the biggest one, mm-hmm. In Cyprus, I mean, every professor, because I have a small study case after the meeting in Brussels 2 months ago, and every professor said that he has his own IT. Mm-hmm. So he's not very much positive to sit down in a classroom and learn more about IT. But anyway, talking about the policies, which is the most important for me, we try to develop a policy to promote e-learning in our universities. And then suddenly, the University of Cyprus decided to start discussions with the Open University of Cyprus to join. So in this case, we couldn't make any kind of policy because we're just waiting for the conventional university, the mm-hmm. University of Cyprus, to see if it can be one with the Open University, so they can take all the infrastructure of the Open University, and then they say that we don't need anything more. So in this case, I really agree that it's not only the policy of the state or the country or the policy that the EU suggests to promote in the countries. It's also the autonomy of the university that sometimes they just stop our policies to go on.
Yeah, I agree with you. You always have to find the good time, you know. Sometimes you have to wait for some years that someone in management shows up with the ideas and it's positive towards something new. And with such person, you can move very fast forward. But sometimes it happens that someone not interested in this come, and then you have to wait. So I tell you at the beginning, it's being patient is very important.
Thank you.
Sometimes I'll come back to you.
Sometimes I believe that it is not that the authorities do not want, but it is taken by lecturers. I'm a lecturer myself. I'm on the way out. I use a lot e-learning, but it is an added thing. So you have, I don't have a full load, but others who have a full load of teaching, so they've got to prepare a lot of things, and then you're asking them to do a lot of more work without being compensated. Mm-hmm. And you are expected to do these new innovations, which is not always that easy, especially for someone who is not accustomed to work in this line of work. So therefore, sometimes it is two-way. Why should I accept this? And rather than discussing with the authorities, whom I know that they are not going to give me extra hours, so I say, I don't want to use new technology. And it's the easy way out.
Yeah, I agree with you. So I said recognition and validation of their work and and like in awarding their work, it's very important because we cannot behave like 20 years ago and asking for new things, you know. Okay, you do it, it's in your time hour, 300 hours you have, but you have to use all new technologies and change the way of teaching. It's not working. We have to change everything, you know, not only teacher, but yeah, the culture. So I said the administration as well and management as well. So it's a big thing, you know. And sometimes you just pick a teacher, say you do it. It's not good.
Hi, thank you, Sandra. Well, my question is, my observation followed by a question is that I find one of the challenges, one of the frustrations is that we see the growth of ICT and open solutions on a pilot-by-pilot basis, where we might not necessarily see replication and bringing up to scale, which is what we want, and which would reflect the trends that are happening in the world. So my question is, it's a difficult one, but when you look at intergovernmental organizations like the EU or like UNESCO, what solutions can we assist you with that might not necessarily be based on funding, but in terms of advocacy or awareness or good practices? And you know, I, if you could be even more specific than the generalities that I'm saying.
I think one of the things is to make clear that teacher training, continuous teacher professional development should be mandatory at higher education. It's not mandatory, it's optional, so it's an issue which should be changed. Finding the way that preparation for modern education, meaning using ICT or online learning, should change the number of hours the teacher usually have for per year, you know. So we have to change here some numbers, you know, saying that, you know, I don't know, this amount of hour for preparation for this amount of time teaching. This should be changed. It cannot stay as it's preparation for classroom teaching. And also, I would say if finances, we cannot neglect them, but projects which will deal with concrete teacher education, you know, like in pedagogy, new teaching methods, student-centered learning, how to move to this model, how to make innovative teaching, critical thinking, including feedback, formative feedback. It's in such an issue. Also, learning outcomes. It's still very difficult for teacher to make good learning outcomes. If we are talking from the program to the course or to the lecture. So these are the first three I just thought about, but I can make more if you want.
Thank you. Any others? We have time for one more. Yes.
Hi, I'm Manuel Zamit from Malta. I'm the director for e-learning, although my department has been, the name has changed to digital literacy now. I would like to share with you just one anecdote. I met with this head of school some 10 years ago, which is how much time I've been struggling with this issue of teacher training. And I asked him, what does he do in Belgium about teachers who don't want to do this change in mentality? He said, don't water rocks. Now, I was walking a few days later in the countryside, and I came across this large boulder with just one flower popping out of this rock. And I said, should I leave it there or water it, you know? So is it watering rocks or not? I think if we just enhance teaching, or rather than enhance teaching, doing the same old thing but using technology will not bring about any change. And that would mean just, as Vincent Zamit has said, it will be just more work for the teacher. But if we try to support the teacher as you are doing, and I don't know how you do it in a, such a large country. Are you just the only center?
The only national e-learning center in the country.
For such a large country.
Yeah.
But anyway, I just can't understand the size, because Malta is so tiny, and I am the leader of the e-learning center as well, and I support all the teachers in Malta, but I'm talking about, I don't know, 6,000 teachers. But anyway, if we try to support these teachers to understand that technology, through technology, we can reach further heights, which we can't reach without technology, then perhaps watering of rocks will be a good idea.
I agree with you. We have to make them aware of the possibilities. All the speakers this morning talked about that we want a new world with everyone employable, with skills, with civil rights. But if we don't change the way we teach people, to make people come out of the schools, of the universities, with skills and ideas and views, how they can improve things and move further, then it's a lost job, I would say, and we are unhappy as a society, all of us. And I just have one more slide. I'm a vice president of Eden, so I will use this opportunity. If you want to discuss further such issues like diversity matters, to come to the Eden conference in Sweden in June. We'll be happy to have you have discussion of this and similar topic as well there. Thank you.
Thank you, Sandra.